13.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the town vote to approve Article 13 and amend the town zoning bylaws as printed in the warrant, beginning with the words by adding Section 8I and adding an additional phrase at the end of the first sentence of the fourth paragraph as follows: or until such time as the town adopts zoning bylaw amendments that regulate large-scale ground-mounted solar photovoltaic systems, whichever occurs first, and by deleting the phrase, or take any action relative thereto.
Okay. Have you been given that one yet? So you're all... You're all set with...
Can we get an explanation of...
Sorry. We have to take care of our business first.
Okay. Oh, so here's the change. So, disregard this, correct? Yeah. Disregard what's in the warrant, and this is how we're going to go with this. Yep. So I'm going to be applying this. So basically, this is a
good. Are you good to go now?
Yep.
Okay, now we're ready for questions, comments. You've got the floor.
Can we just get an explanation of why we're changing the wording in this, on this particular article? Is that you?
Okay. In the process of running this by the powers that be, including the select board and the advisory committee, it was pointed out that while we had a sunset clause that ended at the 2019 annual meeting, we did not, unlike with the marijuana bylaw, have a sunset clause that included ending it sooner if we came up with the bylaw before that date. So this amendment is to address that deficiency. So in other words, if we adopt a zoning bylaw prior to the 2019 annual meeting, then the moratorium goes away. If, however, we do not accomplish that task until the 2019 annual meeting, then that's when the deadline kicks in. Pure as mud, right?
Did I answer your question?
No.
Okay, other.
And Mr. Moderator, I'm
yes.
Elaine Green. I've been working with. I've been working with Sweb Solar Development. I'm on Mitchell Hill where they already put solar, but I'm at the very, very end in my long field. Is surrounded by woods on all sides, and going up the road, you can't even see mine. It's on the other side of the house. But anyway, we've done an agreement with them, except just to sign. And if it passes, I'd like to know if I could be exempt for that, because today that's pretty much my income for the rest of my life. And I've been paying property taxes on that land for about 22 and a half years and never got anything from it. But you can't even see it. The other one on the road down there, you can see it coming up the road. Mine, you can't. Mine is way at the very end past my house with woods all on that side. So if it passed, I wonder if I could possibly be exempt, because we've done everything and agreed, except we haven't signed it yet. My son and I bought that property in 1995, and I left it residential, so we've been paying a lot of taxes on the field up there, only that one long field.
Okay, who's going to try and answer that question with the particulars? Okay, Sharon, go ahead.
Thank you for weighing in.
Yeah. The array permitting process that, I'm sorry, you didn't get it?
What, do you know?
That Elaine Green has referred to, and she did attend the public hearing on this particular solar array on Mitchell Hill. This bylaw has, under paragraph 5, it says, this moratorium shall not apply to any special permit for which application was made prior to the effective date of this bylaw. So the Mitchell Hill project, which is on land owned by Polytexera, is already been verbally approved. We are simply at this point writing up the permit. But for that reason, this bylaw would not apply to that. We felt it was unfair to impose a bylaw that would affect a project that had already been approved and whose permit is being written up. So this moratorium would only affect new permit applications. And I hope that answers your question.
We're all but signing. We've already agreed on it, and we've been working on it for 6 weeks with S Web Solar Development. And I'm just asking if I could be exempt for it.
I'm sorry. Are you talking about a new one? New solar array?
Okay, let me take the floor for a second. The question, as I understand it, is she's in the process of working one of these out. There's not a formal application as of yet. So my question to town council is two. Number one, this, if the bylaw is approved, it's sent to the Attorney General, and it would essentially get approved. The date of that approval is when?
Tonight.
What's that?
Tonight. For zoning bylaw amendments, the approval effective date is retroactive to the date it's voted by the town.
Okay. So, if the bylaw takes effect tonight, is the fact that she started it but hasn't made official approval?
We haven't signed yet, but we got everything done, but just signing, we had to agree on everything with that solar company.
So the answer is?
So I can't speak to a specific application. This bylaw would grandfather anybody who's already made application for a special permit to the planning board.
Okay.
So if that hasn't happened yet, it would be covered by the bylaw. Just based on generalities, without knowing the specifics of any particular application.
Okay.
She's talking about two.
Are you waiting, Pat? Or?
Yeah, she's talking about two different ones for clarification, right?
Right.
You already have an application in for one.
No.
And now you're looking at putting a second one in.
Wait a minute. We need to have the discussion coming through me, and we need to keep it simplified.
This is mine.
And you need to address questions to me before we get going.
Yes, I think there's a little confusion here. I think what Ms. Green is saying is that she has been approached by a solar company about putting an array on her property. Mm-hmm. The same company that is working on the other Mitchell Hill property.
And we've been working on it 6 weeks.
And
we're all done now.
Okay, Ms. Green, unfortunately, you have not submitted a formal permit application to the planning board. So the moratorium would not allow that to go forward. I hope that answers the question. If the moratorium is approved, your project could not go forward until we have a new bylaw in place because you have not submitted a formal special permit application to the planning board.
Point of clarification.
Okay. Right, wait a minute. But we need, if you're going to ask a question, you need to come up here. I'm not. There are people like myself that are part of hearing, so we need to keep people coming up to the mic so everyone gets to hear what's going on and participates in the meeting. I don't want side conversations.
The comment that was made by my fellow planning board member, Russ Faniff, is that this bylaw only applies to ground-mounted solar photovoltaic systems of a certain size. Anything over 250 kilowatts DC, 0.25 megawatts or greater. If Ms. Green's solar project is under that threshold, it can go forward.
Okay, my last question for town council to try and clarify this.
My mom's 84 years old, and you're confusing her, so please.
Wait a minute. Are you a registered voter in Brookfield?
I own the same property.
Are you a registered voter in Brookfield?
No, but you're denying.
Okay, no. You need to listen to me.
You're confusing me.
My question.
He's in the military and he's been in forever.
Just.
Can I make a motion to allow my son to talk? He's in the military.
Is there a second? Okay. What? Give us his name.
Troy Kennedy.
Okay. All those in favor of allowing him to speak, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay. You've got the floor.
Well, I apologize, Mr. Moderator and the board, but. And you wouldn't know, but it is two different properties. So when she was trying to explain her position, you were talking about a different property and confusing her. So my apologies. But my mom and I owned the property since 1995. She doesn't have any income. Her husband passed away and didn't leave her any income. So all she has is a small Social Security check. And then potentially this property that S-Web has approached us and wants to do solar panels. She's been talking for 6 weeks. We agreed on the lease agreement and all the verbiage. They just haven't put in the permit yet because we just made the agreement this week, passing the drafts back and forth. So if this motion is passed, she would be denied that opportunity to close the deal, and she would not have any income for at least a year or more for this property. This is her income for the rest of her life. So it's a big deal for us. I apologize. The timing, it's amazing that the timing just popped up, but this issue popped up on the article just as we're getting ready to close. We would ask that if it does pass, could she at least be exempt so we can finish this deal?
Well, actually, I want to need to clarify one other thing. If it passes and the town meeting tonight happens to adjourn until June, whatever, 28th or something, this bylaw is effective June 15th, or it's effective June 28th?
The statute says the date that the town votes on it.
June 15th.
Today. Tonight.
Okay. Okay. Pat, you have a question, or we're waiting?
I do. I want to know why in the first place do we need this moratorium? I mean, you know, the advisory board does not recommend it, but the selectmen recommend it. Why is the advisory board not recommending it? Why are the selectmen recommending it? And why do we insist on having to have the town tell us what we can do with our own property? I'm sorry, but if someone wants to put a solar panel project on their property, they should be allowed to without the planning board or the selectmen or the advisory board or anybody else to say, no, that's too big, you shouldn't do that.
Okay.
Okay?
To the advisory committee. I'm going to give their response first, so give them a chance.
The advisory committee looks at this as an opportunity to diversify our tax base, encourage businesses that are legitimate. Marijuana was one of them as well, okay? This is legitimate. Also, if there is a bylaw issue here, the other reason that we voted not to support this is go ahead and do your bylaws. There's no reason for a moratorium to allow you to continue to do your work on the bylaws. This is a perfect example why we should not stall this process. I would also like to make a motion to just pass over this article.
Does the selectman want?
Well, I think because of other solar, and again, we'll
deal with what's in front of us. In front of us. Oh, okay. All right. So we have received, Board of Selectmen have received numerous complaints about solar facilities within the town. And you can well appreciate that there are folks that ride up and down Route 9 that are not happy. And so part and parcel of what we're trying to do is to give Sharon and the planning board the opportunity to do the right thing. And again, I laud the planning board for attempting to do what the work that they are trying to do. As far as someone in the midst of this, if there's a way to deal with it, we ought to try to find a way. And again, I would defer to planning as an appropriate response.
Okay. How large is this going to be?
Sir, we have 23 acres. It's only going to be a portion of that land.
No, but do you know how many? You know how many?
It's 3.5 kilowatts. 3.5 to 4. I'm sorry, megawatts. 3.5 to 4 megawatts. I have Sarah Rosenblum. I can't think of her name. From S-Web has already proposed it, and it's just a field in the back corner of our property, what have you, and you can't see it from anywhere except for the dead
well,
end road.
No, I just need to know whether the size of this would apply to this.
It's just under 4 kilowatts.
Okay, it would apply. Megawatts. Okay, that's all we need to know.
Yes.
All right. We have two people to speak, and then we have a motion to move the question. So let's, Sharon, you got one spot.
I'd like to address comments about why we need a moratorium, either for this one or for the marijuana. I've been receiving inquiries from solar companies right and left asking about locating large-scale ground-mounted solar arrays in town. I've been answering those questions on a weekly basis. The reason we need a moratorium is because we need breathing room to consider this without simultaneously having to consider permits that are in the works. Also, this would level the playing field. It means that all of the subsequent applications would be judged under the same criteria with a new bylaw, rather than coming under 7A, which is other on the use regulation table, and then having a company turn around and say, you didn't apply the same rules to them as you did to us. This is to make us consistency in the town zoning bylaws. Now, we realize that there may be people in conversation about these. That is unavoidable. And unfortunately, we received no communication about this earlier, and the timing, regrettably, is not good. But I don't see the wisdom in voting down a bylaw that protects the whole town and gives the town an opportunity to speak to this bylaw for the sake of one person, as regrettable as that may be. Again, this would give, a moratorium would give the planning board time to have public hearings and informational sessions so that we can get feedback from as many people as possible prior to instituting a zoning bylaw.
Okay. Ms. Meyer, if I may respond real quick, I just want to know how it protects the town.
Wait, I have one other question. Let me take these people in line here and get this moving.
I support the moratorium. I think it would gives us a chance to think about this thing a little bit. My proposal would be, and I understand the advisory's concern about increasing revenues into this town. God knows this town needs it. We need some business. We need more money coming in. Take the burden off of the homeowner and the taxpayer. But you need to do it logically. I think the moratorium gives you that opportunity. My proposal, and I will make this motion, that this be tabled until the next town meeting on the 28th.
I won't be here to tell you.
Second.
Okay, motion is made and seconded to table this motion. Let me think about this because I know what you're trying to do.
Yeah, we do. Right.
You really we have the motions from before. to move the question. So we really can't take, I can't take that now. I know what you're trying to do, but we can't take it. It's a little bit late to do that. And that's why I asked the question before of town council, the effective date of this, because this town meeting is not likely to end before midnight tonight. Well, it is likely to end before midnight and to continue later in the month. But if the date is tonight, then that's the way we do it. So we're done. We're done with the questions. We move the question. We're ending debate. So the question is, do we end debate on this? That's what we're going to vote on. Okay? Yeah?
I don't think that was his vote.
Yeah, that wasn't
his vote. Motion was
pass over. Motion was to pass over.
Oh, all right, fine. Motion is made to pass over. There was a second?
Yes.
Okay. Do we have a motion? Okay. Go ahead. What's that?
We already had a main motion on the table.
Yeah, and so he's going to make a motion to pass over it. That's an acceptable motion. So we're going to debate the motion to whether or not to pass over. Any discussion on whether or not to pass over this article? That's what I want to know. Oh, yes.
If we pass over this...
Microphone.
Sorry. If we pass over this question, can we bring it up again at the next, at the extended town meeting?
Yeah. Under two circumstances. One, someone give notice tonight that they're doing it, and then it would have to come up again under reconsideration. But the vote, first vote would be whether or not to reconsider it. And then if no motion, no notice is given tonight that it's going to be reconsidered, then it needs to come up with a 4/5 vote at the next meeting. So yes, there is a procedure to do it, and that's the procedure. Are we ready to vote on whether or not to pass over this article?
What about the ones in line before you take that vote?
All right, go ahead.
I'm on the planning board. We're not here to stifle businesses, and I'm definitely not a guy in town that likes all the bylaws that we have in this town. Way too many. But this one, it should be put in place at some time. You can pass over it whenever, but we need to do it at some point, because these solar arrays, when Mitchell Hill came, the biggest thing people were concerned about is they don't want to see them. And it's the same thing on Route 9 down across from the clam box. That's the biggest thing in town. People do not want to see the solar arrays. And if you live across the street from a solar array, you want to make sure that it's got some kind of screening. And that's one of the things that we're trying to do on the planning board. We're not trying to, all the solar farms, that's fine, but we just want to make sure that we have some kind of ammunition when people come to us that we can put in place so the neighbors are happy as well as the owners and operators. That's the key for this. That's one of the key things on this bylaw. Thank you.
Mr. Chafee, were you going to speak, or you?
I would like to, real quick.
Go ahead.
But if I was to put in one a little bit bigger than what you're calling here to for my family, which legally I can do, I can sell my solar to the family around town by law. It's not much bigger than a couple of family right here. So this is based on small solar things for families, and that's it. It's not much bigger than that. You know, they're not, you know, the 3 or 4 acres there is, you know, nothing to feed, you know, to do the solar on the family houses and stuff. So my motion, I don't vote against this, but that's my opinion.
Okay. Motion is now up before the floor to pass over this article. All those in favor, we'll take a voice vote, but I think I'll need a standing vote before I'm finished. All those in favor of passing it over, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say no.
No.
Okay, I need my counters up. I think it's not going to get passed over, and we're going to keep talking about it. So, all those in favor of passing it over, would you please stand? And my counters are working their way from the back again. Again, this is passing it over. All those in favor of passing it over.
A simple majority carries for the passover, right? Or does it require a two-thirds vote? No, it's a two-thirds for approval.
Right.
So the passover is just a simple majority?
Yes.
Okay.
23. Okay. Okay. All those opposed to passing this over, please stand. The motion is passed over by a vote of 55-19. Just for your knowledge, moderators around the state, these are the two articles we've just discussed, are the two most common articles to appear across the state this year. And there have been lots of issues with it, so I was somewhat ready for it, but there's always something new.
Mr. Moderator.
Okay, now.
Mr. Moderator.
What's that?
Mr. Moderator.
Yes.
I would like to make a motion to have this question reconvened at our extended meeting.
No, you don't make it. You just put on notice that you're going to do it.
Okay.
Okay.
So said.
All right. Okay, now, are you looking to make a motion, Mrs. Lincoln? Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I move that the town vote to take the following articles out of order: 30, 34, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 48, 49, 50, and 51.
All right, we're going to have a 30-second timeout up here. I'm going to repeat those numbers before I go on with anything and explain it. 34, 38, 30, 34, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 48, 49, 50, 51?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Before we hear why she wants to do this or the select board want to do this, after she gives the explanation, if we vote to do this, then we will go through and talk about these motions starting now in the order in which she has listed them. When we're finished doing that, then we'll come back to Article 14, and at that point, we'll see where we are in the evening and see what we do from that point. So, I want to give you one more chance to look at these and see if there are any that she's listed that you don't want to pull out, that you do want to pull out, because otherwise I'm prepared to accept her motion to take all of these out of order right now and start working our way through them. Well, no discussion? Okay. So, all those in favor of taking the articles out of order and working through this list first, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. Okay, we have a new order of articles. So, you need to give me a minute up here. Okay. Article 30. To see if the town will vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen and or Library Board of Trustees to lease certain real property and the improvements thereon, commonly known as 18 Common Street, Brookfield, as written in the warrant. I'll take a motion.
Mr. Moderator.
Yes.
I move that the town vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen and the Library Board of Trustees to lease certain real property and the improvements thereon, commonly known as 18 Common Street, Brookfield, described with the Worcester South Registry of Deeds in Book 17143, page 134, for such period of years and upon such terms and conditions as the Board of Selectmen and the Library Board of Trustees shall determine to be appropriate. And further, to raise and appropriate $8,250 for the rent for the initial year of said lease. And further, to authorize the Board of Selectmen and Library Board of Trustees to enter into an option to purchase said property. And further, to authorize the Board of Selectmen and Library Board of Trustees to execute any and all documents to carry out the intent of this article.
Second.
Before you go, Do you have a copy of that over there, Michael? You all set with this?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
And I would also like to ask permission for the library director to speak, please.
Okay. Permission for the library director. Okay. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no? Okay. Right, they're raising and appropriating.
Okay, so I'd like to give you a timeline. I'm Brenda Menterville. I'm the library director in town here. I'd like to give you a timeline of how we've arrived at this project, so to speak. When I started in 1999, we started a building program study for $40,000 and concluded in 2001 that we needed to own adjacent property in order for us to expand or add on for the Mass Board of Library Commissioner standards. So we had an opportunity to look at 4 Lincoln Street in 2008. We started talking about it in October of 2008. And by February of 2009, Mr. Holdcraft had purchased it for $85,000. So we lost out on that opportunity. So, and I believe our neighbors were on the building committee at the time, so they recognized the fact that we had lost that opportunity. So when they decided to put their property on the market, they approached us with this presentation to lease the property to own it while they're doing renovations. They're doing the roof in the barn and some other needed improvements on the interior. So we wanted to also have this 1-year period for the Friends of the Library, who are now 501c3, to raise monies for this project. So they've raised $14,000, and $8,250 of it came from the Friends to pay half of the lease. Does anybody have any questions?
Mr. Moderator, if I may?
Yes.
I just want to explain why the advisory board did not support this article. The roof was a big part of it. There wasn't enough information are you getting it at market price? Or are you going to get a discount on it? Because if it goes on the market, it's, you know, I'd like to know how it's going to be, how the appraisal is going to go with it, if it's going to be top market value, or if you're going to get a better deal on it. Because honestly, if it goes on the market, the condition it's in, it shouldn't really fetch that great of a price at the moment, I don't believe. We're also concerned with the amount of money it would take to shore up new foundation, things like that, being the age of the house, and how many challenges we would have and how much money it would cost to make the house handicap accessible so that it's usable.
Okay, so the house is on the National Historic Register, so going from a private residence to a commercial is why we want to have this one-year period to explore that with an architect who knows what he's talking about. He has already suggested that we work with an architectural engineer to make sure the, you know, and tell us what issues that we need to address. We really hope we can use the house because a Mass Board of Library Commissioner grant application is, they multiply your square footage, your town population, they multiply it by 25 to 50 years, and the cost of the projects that are going on right now are Webster's in the 11 million range, Lester's in the 8 million range. They're just, we don't want to do that. So, I lost my train of thought, Tony. We'll be back on track.
It's my understanding the library needs a septic, too. Is that correct?
Correct.
Do you know, it might not be known yet, but do you know if both properties need a septic? And if so, have you discussed doing a shared septic between the two properties, if so?
That's on the table.
Okay, question up here.
What does this commit us to in the way of, how are we bound by this 8250?
It was recommended that it go from July 15th to July 15th of 2019, and that's this agreement for that 1 year. And then the next part is to actually purchase the property. We have done an appraisal. It came in lower than what is in the lease agreement. The lease agreement is still going back and forth between town council and the owner's lawyer. So it now has to go back to town council because a number of their concerns need to be addressed.
So does this bind us to that second step of purchasing?
No, it does not.
I see Peter behind you. I'd like to hear from the capital planning as to why they also voted to not support this.
Okay.
The capital planning committee did have a number of discussions with Brenda and Matt Bansfield about the proposed project. Our capital planning committee, I should say, is a relatively new committee, but we've worked hard on developing a capital plan. And what we've tried to do is establish standards for giving our support to projects. Our committee voted 6-1 to not be in favor of this project, primarily because it's such a project in such transition. We have reservations about the use of the house. We've been told that it will be a joint project with the Historical Commission, but we haven't heard from the Historical Commission. We've been told that the plan is to work with the town where the library would take over the management of the town's historical records and help put those in order. But what we don't see yet is a concrete proposal. There's sympathy, there's tremendous admiration for Brenda and her staff in the library. We feel it is a jewel in the town. But we can't, as a committee, in good conscience, approve this because we don't know what it is. Yes, it's a lease, but we're not confident that all of the options are on the table, such as moving the house, such as tearing the house down, All we hear is pretty much a reusing of the house. And most of our members are skeptical that the house can be put in shape, made accessible, and both floors of the house be used. If we're not making the upstairs accessible, it's a fairly expensive operation. And we don't see in the planning yet what other options might be. Could the house be moved? Can a septic system, Mike Siri tells us that a small septic system could be installed on the library lot itself without needing the adjacent land to satisfy the library's need for a septic system. So part of this comes down to the fact that this is a project in transition. It's come up fairly quickly. The library does need a lot of input, but our committee is not feeling at this point that they can support the project, regrettably.
I understand their approach in that this has come about quite quickly. The library has a limited space. They do a great job of what they have for space. I do also agree that there are things about this project that we don't know. If you approve this tonight, it gives you a year to work out the finer points. Let me just ask a couple of questions about the lease. Does the sale price remain the same from today to the end of the lease?
The sale price is negotiable. There is a number in the lease, but I don't think that's how much we're going to pay.
Okay, but what I'm asking is, if I don't know what the figures are, if the price today, the sale price today, or appraisal price is $200,000, say they get an offer for $400,000 in a year, do we still have the option of buying it at the $200,000? Is that part of the lease?
I believe the lease is called a lease to option with option to purchase.
Okay. So does any of the money from the lease go toward the purchase?
The owners have said a percentage of. We haven't worked out the percentage.
Okay. All right. So if you pass this, it gives you a chance to work things out. It sounds like the sale price or the appraised price now will be the same today as it would be in...
I think there's a 3% increase in the price.
Okay. Right. Thank you.
I believe there's a 3% increase in the sale price.
Hi, I'm Karen Reynolds from the Friends of the Library. We have put up half the rental price to pay for the first year, so that will decrease it for the town. It was originally $17,000, and we've raised the money to put up half. And this doesn't come along often to have a chance with adjacent property on the town common. It is the original owner of the land that was donated to the library, this house. I think it was Felton. Mrs. Felton donated the property to the library, so it would be combining the two properties back together again. It would give space for Mr. Wilder's map to be stored instead of in a box in the library. He donated all his maps and literature to Brookfield Merrick Library, and it would be a shame to just have all those hidden away. The historical committee would be able to operate there and have meetings. It would give us a chance to have a handicap bathroom, which we're right now, you know, we don't really have. So right now, it's got a lot of pluses. All we're asking is to vote for a year of rental, and it's not going to really cost the town that much money. Thank you.
Thank you. Right now, I'm in real estate, and if someone came to me with a deal like this, I would definitely say, no, we don't know. Brenda, what's the price that we're going to pay possibly in a year?
We don't have a price. So
you don't? Okay. That's all right.
Well, In the lease, it's $245. The appraisal came in at $200,000.
So we got an appraisal around $200,000, and we're gonna get a contract around $250,000, and all this work that's gonna have to be done to this house. I mean, besides all that, we need to have the townspeople here, the taxpayers need to know what they're buying, what we're getting into, what's this gonna cost to get this thing up and running. We don't know. It might be this, might be a 3% increase, you just said. I mean, we're gonna vote on what? We need to know what we're voting on here, dollars and cents. This is a business decision for the taxpayers. And if we just willy-nilly, yeah, we're gonna do this, we're gonna do that, we're gonna rent it for a year. I mean, we need to know what this house is. Have we had an engineer look at the house? Is it good?
We haven't signed a lease yet.
Have you had an engineer look at the house?
We've had a home inspection.
And how did it come back? I heard it came back, it's a pig in a poke. Is that true?
I'm not a librarian, I can't interpret it.
All right. So anyway, I'm gonna vote against it because there's just too many ups and downs. And I mean, if it was me buying the house, I wanna know what I'm getting into. Thank you.
Over here, before.
Brenda, over here. Brenda, I'd also like to thank you for all the library does. I'd like to ask some questions about the project. Okay. I understand the ask is for between $8,000 and $9,000 for this year, but you've mentioned some things. You said something about bringing an architect in to look at the building to figure it out. So what I'm trying to understand is, what else might the town need to spend over the coming year so that the library as an organization can make a decision about whether it would want to exercise that purchase price? What other costs are we committing to this coming year? And if we don't, if at the end of that year the determination is that the property is just not, cannot be made suitable at an affordable price, what are we still on the hook for?
Okay, so we have a very generous trustee board, and we've already started working with an architect that a trustee is paying for. So we're not gonna go to the town and ask for any more money to go to this house. We already have raised money for operating costs. If we actually occupy the house, we're not sure. We just wanna have the opportunity to explore it.
Mr. Moderator, if I may follow up?
No.
All right. So what you're saying is you're asking for $8,000 to $9,000 from the town for the option to lease it for a year, to give yourself some time to figure out what you're going to do in terms of purchase price and negotiate all that, and in 1 year time you will come to the town and with a plan for what you're going to do and with the costs associated with that plan.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Al Jones, Assessor's Office. On February 28th, I went out and measured the outside of the house to verify the square footage. On May 1st of this year, I went and met with Brenda and several others and inspected the interior. Initially, we had this valued at $241,600. As a result of walking around and looking at the outside and the inside, we dropped it to $222,900. That takes into consideration the entire house. I don't know if the appraisal was the entire house or just the first floor that would be used. The first floor square footage that's usable is 1,268. Second floor living area, 1,512. There's 336 square feet of storage on the first floor that's believed to be unheated in the back. And I had it in below average condition on an average design and grade. Any other questions for the assessing piece?
Mr. Moderator, if I may.
Yeah.
You mentioned just the usable first floor. Is it only the first floor that's usable in this building?
Well, someone mentioned earlier about handicap access.
Sorry. I heard somebody say that handicap I was wondering, are there handicap bathrooms in there already? So the mention of handicap bathroom was just in the future when we build them and pay for them.
I have no knowledge of that.
And my other question would be to Brenda. During the home inspection, was there a lead test done on the house?
No, that's a separate test.
Okay, I was just wondering.
That's what we're going to have to do. It's on the list. We have National Grid for MassSave. We have a number of other inspections we have to do.
The year built is, we have is 1814, mm-hmm. more than likely.
Yeah, exactly.
How are you?
I have a couple of questions. What grants have you looked into at this point? What grants have you looked into in order to maybe, I mean, it's on the historical registry, so there are some historical grants that are out there for restoration. Have you looked into any of that?
That's what we plan to do this year.
Okay, but have you already looked into it?
No.
Okay, so you're coming to the town, you're asking the town to purchase a property, lease a property, rent a property, I'm sorry, with the option to purchase, but you haven't gone outside of the box yet to say, okay, well, we've looked into this grant, we've looked into that grant, it's a possibility that we may only have to come up with $100,000 versus $245,000 on a property that may cost us another $100,000 for it to become working condition for the library to actually functionally use it. So now you're talking about a $300,000 project. We're not talking about just purchasing a property and storing some books in it. We're talking about literally opening this building up to the public. So before we start to worry about, I mean, what happens if you come back to the town and the town says, we don't want to spend that kind of money, and you and your friends of the library have put all this money into this building that we don't own, and we're not going to own because the town will say, no, we're not going to purchase it, then what happens to all of the stuff that we have in there? Where are we going to put all that stuff if the town comes back and says, I'm sorry, we don't want to purchase this house now?
So this is basically about studying the property. I don't foresee us moving into it anytime soon unless things get done by the owners that will allow us to do that.
Okay, so then why would we pay rent to study a property? That's ridiculous. Okay, we can continue to study the property while the owners own it and not pay them rent to study their property. They absolutely could sell it, but that's an option that we have to look at. That, you know what, if it's something that's not a good deal and it's not feasible for us to purchase it and to put all that money into it, and they sell it to someone else, it's no different than what happened next door with the property on Lincoln Street. That got sold out right from underneath the library as well.
So we're trying to prevent that.
Well, you know.
Okay, we have some more.
You can go ahead. It's for the town.
Brenda, one of the big issues that I think for the Capital Planning Committee, and I think you're hearing here, is that the lease is not yet finished. How long would it be before the lease is finished?
We believe another 2 weeks because it has to go back to town council. I asked Linda Lincoln for permission to use town council, so it's like a two-step process. I'm not going to go behind anybody's back.
All right. If we were not to act on this this article tonight and brought it up either at the adjourned town meeting or in a special town meeting, I would think that many of the questions that you're getting here might be answered. And therefore, I think we should consider, I'm not going to make the motion right here to pass over this, but I think that may be the wisest thing of for the town to consider.
I think I had a question from, did you want to say something? Or?
So one of the things that I just wanted to state is that, yes, the contract is still under negotiation so that we don't have all of the details to present to the town tonight. But I really want to reframe this because people have kind of taken this pretty far afield at this point. We are talking about an $8,300 commitment or an $8,250 commitment in order to, instead of being on a two-week timeline or a three-month timeline, to have a year of some very dedicated people who at least conceptually understand that, first of all, we are not a town that wants to pay $8 million for a Mass Library, whatever they call it. I'm probably going to get it wrong if I try to state the full organization's name. Entity type library expansion. We are trying to do a Brookfield style home improvement, do-it-yourself library improvement, okay? And yeah, there's a potential for this to look like an episode of This Old House, okay? But we're not talking about signing up for the house tonight. We're talking about signing up for a year to figure out what's best for the town and not put ourselves in a position like what happened to us a decade ago and lose the opportunity to make a considered decision, okay? I don't think that an $8,250 commitment is too much to ask from a town meeting to give the real runway, running ground for some very dedicated folks to put their plan together. We've spent more than that on three different sewer plans that have never come to light in this town, okay? That's been going on, okay? And so honestly, folks, let's just, I'm begging you to consider this from what the potential upside is versus the risk. Risk small, upside big. Okay, we're not signing up for anything tonight but the $8,250 to buy a year to figure this out.
Hi, I'm Bill Simpson. I just want to commend the folks at the library, Brenda, and everybody for all the work on this. It's come quickly, and there's a lot of information and a lot of questions, but I would encourage everyone to support their efforts because there's a lot of questions that are coming up today that there's just not enough time in the day for Brenda to have all the answers for at this moment right here. But if we give them the support of this, and the trustees have already paid for half of this lease, and it's a relatively small amount of money for the town. And in a year, Brenda's gonna come back with a slew of answers to all these questions that we have, and we'll know a lot more. The building will be different because the owners and the trustees will work together to make, you know, the small modifications that may be all that we need to make some use of this space. And like Beth had pointed out, there were studies done before to put the addition on recommended by the Mass Board of Library Directors 10 years ago was a $3 or $4 million project. And we're looking for $8,000 to see what we can do with this house. We're not looking for a $3 or $4 million project. All right, thank you.
Mr. Auburn, you were patient.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Moderator. I just have a few different points. While I appreciate that this old house, beautiful painting that Beth gave us all, we also had a former selectman arguing over $13 a few minutes ago, so obviously money is important to everyone in this town. With lead, with handicap accessibility, there's just so much, it just seems like a money pit. But I'm wondering, since Bill said that, I know the Board of Trustees has the money for half the lease, is there an option to do a six-month lease and have them cover it and then come back at the special and then ask the town to cover the second 6 months once we have some information? Is that an option?
I think it's a good option.
If that's the case, then, you guys do an amazing job. I agree with everybody. You have to look at it from my eyes. I'm just looking at it for the money of the town. If it's doable and it's not going to be a complete money hole, I would say go for it too. But it's just so, like everyone's saying, it's very, we don't know anything. So I would like to make a motion that we pass over and maybe have the trustees ask Mr. Heller if we can do a six-month lease. We can revisit this at the special town meeting in the fall. And then if it makes sense, we can put an article on there and we'll pick up the second half of the lease as a town, or we can vote on it, which I'm sure the town will if it's going to be something that makes sense, and then we can move the project forward.
The motion is made and seconded to pass over the article. So you want to talk about that for a second? Or? Okay.
I'm just in line. It doesn't matter. I mean, if you want to.
That's to move the question.
Yep.
Passing over, we handle that a little bit differently. So, if you want to say something, go ahead, and then we'll take a vote on the passing over. But remember, the passing over is a Passover period, It doesn't have anything to do with committing the trustees to something, because you can't commit an outside organization to do something. So we won't, just so I get that clarified. Okay.
Can you clarify that, Mr. Moderator?
If we pass over this, that's what we're doing. We're passing it over. Now, what the trustees do is their business in a private way. We don't have any control over the Friends of the Library. It's a private organization, what they're doing. Okay? All right. Ms. O'Connell, speak, and then we'll...
Just a quick thought. I am a little concerned about the... what feels to be a big push that we're going to somehow make this property work for, because we lost out on another adjacent property. We need the space. We need program space. The library, I absolutely agree, is desperate for program space, for storage space, et cetera. But I guess I would like some assurance that part of this lease period would not just be studying, okay, how do we fix this property up, but whether we really do want to purchase this, and whether it is going to be a $2 million project to get this into some kind of condition where it will be a really usable thing that the library really does need. And just because it's there doesn't mean it's right to do. It is convenient and all of that, but I just want some assurance that the library trustees and the library, that the library will establish some kind of building committee, that they will do a needs assessment, a space needs assessment, that they will really get their ducks in a row so that when they come to town meeting, they can say, we need X square footage of this and that. We need, in order to use this house, we would need to put in X amount of dollars to make that happen. Or we've studied all this, and guess what, folks? It isn't, we've had this year on reflection, it ain't gonna work. I just need some assurance that it is not a freight train that's left the yard and that has no other option but to buy this house eventually. I would like the option to be there, and it's in the lease. It's an option to purchase. It's not a requirement to purchase, and I know that. But all I hear really from trustees and from Friends of the Library is we're going forward with this. This is a great opportunity. And it may be, but I haven't seen the data that tells me that, either from the perspective of the library defining its needs clearly with something that I could read about, or with an assessment of this particular property and how that would fit with those needs. So if I could get, I like the idea of a 6-month lease and see how much progress can be made, and maybe at that point the trustees and the Friends of the Library can come forward with something that is has a little bit more shape to it, so that and maybe a little more understanding of the feasibility and what the costs might be down the road.
All right. Any other discussion on passing over the article? I don't want to get the merits of it. I want to just... Okay, so we're going to vote to pass over the article. If you want to vote to pass it over, you're going to say aye. If you don't want to vote to pass it over and you want to continue the discussion, you're going to vote no. Okay? So all those in favor of passing over the article, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say no.
No.
Counters, assume your positions. Okay, all those in favor of passing over the article, would you please stand? How many? 16?
14.
Okay. All those opposed to passing over the article and continuing the discussion, would you please stand? And counters will work their way from the...
them first. Right. I don't know. Makes sense. My opinion.
23.
Seven?
Seven.
You're kidding. Okay. The motion is 30 to pass over and 30 not to pass over. What's that?
Am I eligible, though?
Yep.
Yes.
Because I raised my hand. I don't think he was counting. I was to pass over. I don't know.
Did you count him? One way or the other?
Mike?
Yeah.
I just raised my hand. I raised my hand to...
I'm sorry, I didn't see it.
To pass over.
I did not count you.
Okay. Do you want to stay at the tie?
Well, you have to decide. I mean, if you honestly voted, then we count it, and it's the motion is passed over. If it's a tie vote, then I... Okay. So, it's passed over. That's where we go. All right. What's the next one, Linda? 34?
Could I make a motion for a recount? I think we might have missed the girls at the back, too. And it was a tie, so.
Okay.
It's my first time.
All right. And I want you to come back and do it again, so. All right. Try this one more time. If you're in favor of passing over the article and not having any more, we're done with it, would you please stand? Counters will start from the back, work to the front, and we'll get a number.
You're standing.
17. 16.
Okay. All those who do not want to pass over this article, who want to continue it, please stand.
Nine.
Well, we had more people vote this time, and this time 33 voted to pass over. We went up three, and 34 decided not to pass it over. So that is defeated. That went up four. So now we're back to discussing Article 30. Anybody have anything new to add to this?
Let's move the question.
Thank you.
Okay. So before we take a vote on this, I have a question for Town Council.
Harper was on her way up.
What's that?
She wasn't at the mic. She was on her way up before they moved the question.
Okay. I'm sorry.
I'm Barbara Clancy. I am one of the trustees at the library, and I've lived in this town for 60 years. And I have seen more stupid things happen at town meeting than you could keep on feet, toes, and fingers. This is an opportunity given to us by a family who really likes this town and thought they would be willing to give us a reasonable price for the house so that for a year we can see if we can make it fit. We're asking you for a little over $8,000, and I think we're entitled to it. We work very hard up there, and Brenda breaks her neck, as does the rest of the staff. And this may mean that this family may say, forget it. And that would be really sad, because we're asking that you only spend the eight, not $8 million. And I know you fought over $15, but.
Mr. Moderator, may I respond real fast?
Okay. Well, I need to ask the town council a question first. This is a vote to authorize a lease. This requires what vote for approval?
Two-thirds.
And it requires two-thirds because?
Good evening. So it requires two-thirds for two reasons. One, for it's an acquisition of an interest in land with an appropriation, and also because the Department of Revenue takes the position that lease purchase agreements are tantamount to borrowing. I mean, it's not going to impact your bond rating, but it's they view it as borrowing, and that's why it would require two-thirds vote.
So even though we're not purchasing it and we're not borrowing money, both of those situations apply. Okay. It's a good thing you're here, because I wouldn't have interpreted it that way. All right. So, do you want to make last comments before we take a vote here pretty quick?
Yeah, I'm just trying to understand the procedural situation. So, I mean, if it takes two-thirds and we've already split on whatever we're doing, it's a,
Mr. Moderator?
Yes.
I'd make a motion that we move to vote on the article.
I second. Okay. Motion to move the question so we can end debate. Oh, well, let's.
No, vote.
Right, but the only way we take a vote is to end debate on it.
Second.
Thank you. Okay, any discussion on ending debate? No. All those in favor of ending debate, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Okay, the debate's over. Now we're going to vote on the motion. All those in favor of the motion, it's $88,250 for a one-year lease. Would you please stand?
I don't know.
That's in a couple of months.
I got a waffle on that one.
You and Tom are wafflers. 25. I expect another Tom. I didn't expect that.
Okay, all those opposed to Article 30, would you please stand?
Six.
Well, that's that wrong.
Four.
The article is approved, 63-10.
I want to thank everyone, and if you'd like to join the Friends, we're in need of a secretary, a treasurer, and a vice president.
Okay, who's got, Mrs. Lincoln, are you going to have Article 34? Okay, Article 34. To see if the town will vote to aggressively enforce the littering and trash disposal laws by ticketing as prescribed in Massachusetts general laws as written in this, and I'll let Mrs. Lincoln make the motion.
I move
I move that the town vote to aggressively enforce the littering trash disposal law by ticketing as prescribed under Massachusetts General Law 5, Title 1, Chapter 270, Section 16.
Okay. Motion made and seconded. Some discussion on this one.
Mr. Moderator, I was wondering if anybody from the police force was here to explain to us why they don't enforce this law.
We do enforce the law.
So why do we have this?
Microphone.
I'm just asking.
Wait. We need people up here before we...
Because it makes you look like you don't. That's why I asked. Well, that's what it does.
We do enforce the law, and I don't know why. I didn't put it on. I think Clarence can speak to that.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, Sam.
Actually, it'd probably be better you speak as to why we have this law. Go ahead. It'd probably be better you speak to have this law before I raise my objections.
Okay, so I personally,
yep.
From Quaybog Equipment to White's Landing, for the last 4 years, mm-hmm. we have picked up so much trash in that one section that it makes the town look terrible. This is not anything to do with the chief and what the chief is trying to do. What this is saying is that there are numbers of people on Earth Day who pick up trash in this town that it is deplorable. And so if nothing else tonight, we are sending a clear message that dump along our roadways is not something that this town wants. That's what the message is.
Okay. I can understand your concern about wanting to give a message, but I have two concerns about this. One is aggressive enforcement. The police chief already says he's enforcing the laws. You really want to enforce these laws, you probably should hire some more police officers. Really, I mean, this is, it's very difficult. You have to catch someone in the act, right? Yeah, okay, the answer is yes. And that's one of the problems here, it's enforcement. But the other concern I have is the way this is written. So some kid tosses out a candy wrapper and you're gonna take away his parents' car? This is a little bit heavy-handed, okay? It's like shooting a mosquito with a shotgun. I really think what's needed here, and again, if you look, the town of Brookfield has a bylaw already against littering. We have no penalties. What really should be done is this should be remanded to the bylaw committee, develop some reasonable penalties for littering, and then there can be discussion about how aggressively we want to enforce these laws. So that's what I think really needs to be done, as opposed to sending a message, which is probably meaningless unless you want to live in a police state.
I can also talk about the trash that's picked up. The Lake Association does the same thing that the same day that the town does it. I don't know how much trash you took, but we took two truckloads that we brought to Brookfield and two more that went to East Brookfield. The trash is a problem. It's something about tires. When you put one tire down, they mate. And there are five. And we picked up five tires in one location and they just multiply. It is a problem. And I encourage aggressive enforcement of it. Matter of fact, I'd double or triple the fines.
Excellent.
Hi, I'm Jane Snyder, and I would ask that the laws be followed, and if we can find out who's dumping the trash, wonderful. I pick up trash not just on Earth Day. I pick it up all year long. Wherever I walk, which is usually a 4-mile radius, I take no less than 20 grocery bags with me every time. And every time they are filled. If you walk down Rice Corner Crossroad, there's a wonderful guardrail and it's hidden by the greenery. Take a look over the edge. I called in 15 tires on one side, 9 propane tanks on the other side, 2 propane tanks on my road. It's everywhere. It's not the candy wrappers. I understand that. Excuse me. But you can teach the children not to throw out the trash. But it's those that drive the cars and chuck everything out the window. But all these items, oars, crutches, televisions, used dishes, half-eaten meals, raw meat, dirty diapers, used cat litter. Tell me, how do you carry all that in your car? I don't think so. These are the things we need to stop. Our roads are beautiful, and I love to walk them. But it takes me a very long time because I'm picking up so much trash. I'd like to just walk, and that would be really, really nice. I do feel the laws need to be enforced. Yes, you have to catch the person. I understand that. But we need to be on the lookout for it. We need to report everyone that we find. And if we find the junk, get it off the roads. Thank you.
I do think we have a problem in our roads, like all the other towns. They all have the same problems. But I think the selectmen should be spending more time getting our finances in order in this town and rather worrying about paper cups. And we do have a problem, I understand that. But I think here tonight, our finances are a disarray. And I think I'll tell you again, you need to get the finances in order and make sure that you have your town employees doing what they're supposed to be doing when they are getting paid. That's what you should be doing.
I am George Hurdle. I ran Earth Day, or whatever we called it there, for the first time, and quite an eye-opener. But we're not talking about cups and paper and that. We're talking about illegal disposal of trash that's been picked up somewhere else, construction stuff, like the lady before me said, TVs. We need the citizens of this town to keep their eyes open, get their cell phones out, take pictures, find out who's doing it, and bring them to the law. Simple as that.
Mr. Moderator, if I may.
Mr. Chafee is...
Well, I want to talk.
Okay.
I agree with everyone. I made the point earlier about the police just to make sure everybody knows that the police are doing their job. I'm not sure if you call with a license plate if they can enforce that against someone or not. I hope they can. At the same time, I know these are big items. I don't know. I think it's something we should look into as a town as to how we can fix this whole thing is maybe do more days at the dump where we have bulk days where we can bring stuff down there or maybe put trash cans around town again so that we can actually throw our trash away. But anyhow, I think we should just vote and move on.
Mr. Chafee, you...
I got a question for Mr. Ceres back there. What's it cost to get rid of a tire at the transfer station? Our cost to get rid of it out of there?
$3.
$3. Mm-hmm. So the 40 tires that I picked up on Lake Road and Rice Corner Crossroad, that seems to be the key spot. That's big bucks. Right now, I think there's about 25 tires out there, and we just picked it up, 2 months ago.
Yep, we're taking
it right in. The tires end up in the same neighborhood, and most of the trash ends up in the same neighborhood. So it's very costly to the town, and I agree that it needs to be enforced and enforced big time.
Something new, Mr. Cook?
Yeah, I have a question. How many trash barrels do we have available in this town? None. Well, that's... Oh, Louisville has 3 trash... I would like to amend this motion to appropriate $200 to buy trash barrels to put throughout town.
No? Want more? I think it's ridiculous. You have a...
That's above and beyond what the article calls for. I mean, it's a small amount of money, and I would be tempted to accept it because it's a small amount of money. But the ramifications of that become much more expensive.
Okay. Can I knew you were going to rule me out of order, Mr. Moderator, but I want to make a point.
Well, don't test me.
I wanted to raise a point here because you're coming forward to say a message. Do you want a solution to this problem? Go pull out some trash barrels in town. Go lower the dump fees. Do something constructive. Don't send messages.
Let me correct the number of trash barrels that are in town. There are 4. They're supported by the Lake Association. I was told by the highway superintendent 5 years ago when I put them out that it wouldn't work. We empty them on a regular basis. We don't collect a lot of household trash. It all ends up on the road. Everything that we collect at the boat ramp and the beaches is local trash. So there are trash barrels, they are effective.
I'd just like to say that, you know, everything is common sense. If you put a grocery bag in your car and throw your garbage in it, instead of throwing it out the window like we always did before, we wouldn't have this problem. But people have gotten lax, and I think it's time that they start doing their own jobs.
Well, my name is John Washburn, and I'm thinking that if we're they're seeing this trash in certain areas, they put cameras out for deer and everything else. Put a camera out there. If they're dumping that spot, you're going to have a picture of who's doing it and catch them, and there'll be no issues. There'll be less people getting caught. You don't have to raise the fees. You just have to have another way of finding who it is.
Sharon Mahoney, my sense about this is that the problem is not so much the people who toss their McDonald's boxes out the window. The problem is the people who do what is known as illegal dumping. That is the wholesale dumping of mass quantities of items that should go to the transfer station in order to avoid the fees at the transfer station. The people think they're more economical to discard this trash in our roads than to act like a good citizen and bring it to the transfer station, or to come in from another town because these laws are not being enforced and throw it on the road. That's why I think the wording of aggressive enforcement is not only appropriate but necessary, because if we can't catch the little guy who's tossing trash out of his window, at least we can get the people who are doing the mass quantities of dumping, and there are ways to find out who is doing this. I support this warrant article.
I move the question.
Okay, motion is made and seconded to end the debate on this. All those in favor of ending debate, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say no. Okay, debate is ended. So now we're down to the motion for Article 34. Do you need it repeated? Okay. All those in favor of Article 34, would you please say aye?
Aye.
All those opposed, please say no. The ayes have it. So 34 is passed. Next one I have is 38. To see if the town will vote to amend Article 5, Section 5A of the town bylaws in accordance with the statutory changes made by the Municipal Modernization Act.
Yeah.
All right, who's got the motion on this one?
I've got that, Mr.
You, good, thank you.
I move that the town vote to approve Article 38 as written in the town warrant, except with the phrases "to take any action relative thereto" be omitted.
Second.
This is basically brought down from state. Oh, sorry. This is actually mandated.
Okay. Any discussion on this change to the bylaws? Oh, okay. All those in favor of Article 38, would you please say aye?
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay, Article 38 is approved. The next one I have is 39.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the town vote to accept the provisions of Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 60, Section 15B, and establish a tax title revolving fund for the fiscal year commencing on July 1st, 2018, as recommended by the Board of Selectmen for the purposes as stated in the town warrant and as may be permitted by law.
Okay. Any discussion on this one? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Okay. The next one I have is 40. To see if the town vote to amend Chapter 15 of the Personnel Bylaws, Section 2, mandatory classification to include the position of grant writer, facilitator, or take any action relative thereto. Who's got this one?
Mr. Moderator?
Yes.
I move that the town vote to amend Chapter 15 of the Personnel Bylaws, Section 2, Mandatory Classification, to include the position of grant writer facilitator at the grade and points to be determined by the Personnel Board.
Okay. Motion made and seconded. Any discussion on this one? Go ahead, Carol.
Is there any salary attached to this, or is that in a line item somewhere? Or? It is?
It's in a line item. Oh, okay.
I didn't hear the answer.
It's in the consultant's budget.
From the line item?
Yes. Mr. Moderator?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. This is an idea on the part of the selectmen, that we would in fact have a grant writer facilitator, because as we all know, and I see Mr. Simpson in the back, the efforts that they put in and around the town hall, we've had huge success, I would say, in the highway department because of someone that's focused on grant writing and the like, and we have a town hall that needs great repair. And with that, if we had a person that was out actually aggressively looking for dollars, that we might be successful. Thank you.
So I just have a question for the selectmen in regards to this position. Have you given any thought to hiring this person more as a contractor as opposed to a town employee? My concern is with future benefits and things of that nature. Can you give me some information on that?
My thought, Mike, again, back to we've got some consulting and we don't manage it. If we had an employee where we could in fact manage that time, we would be more effective.
Do we anticipate this employee working for 20 or more hours per week?
Basically, it's the 20 hours. That would be my recommendation and thought. At least see, again, at 20 hours a week, you would see what kind of efforts you could do or success that you could have. I mean, if we look at the success that we have in one area of town, if we could match that, it would be terrific.
Just one more thought. I think I expressed this to you before, but the thought was looking into the prospect of hiring somebody that could be a grant writer for the Brookfields and perhaps sharing that, and so I wonder what your thoughts are on that. I'm just worried about adding another employee that's going to be eligible for benefits and putting this person on. I'm just concerned about another position in town.
Respect that, Mike.
Okay. We've always had money in the budget for grant writing, have we not? Yes, I believe we have. Right, Bobby? We've always had money in the $10,000 at one point when people were writing grants, and it was under the consultant budget years in the past when I was on the advisory board. I guess my question is why aren't we doing it the same way as we've done it in the past, where we paid that consultant who is writing the grant a percentage of the grant instead of actually hiring someone to sit there and you know, if they have grants that they can write, what are they gonna do when there aren't any grants available to write? We're going to be paying them 20 hours a week to do what? Twiddle their thumbs? Or another job in the town hall? So my theory is that, I mean, do we write enough grants to constitute a 20-hour a week position for 52 weeks out of the year? It's kind of hard to comprehend that we would have that amount of grant writing in the town, that there are that many grants available in the Massachusetts or federal government that we could pay someone for that amount of time. I think we should just do it the way that we've always done it and pay them a percentage of the for their grant writing time as a consultant and not as an hourly waged employee. Pat, if you read the article, it only says as needed.
So it doesn't mean that they're just going to be coming in for 20 hours every week to get paid. It's
so why do we have to
needed.
Pay them an hour? Wait,
so, wait, let her finish. Let Mrs. Lincoln finish.
If how much?
CMRPC is managing the CBDG grant. We got an $800,000 grant, and we're paying $80,000 to manage that grant.
That's a manager. That's not a grant writer. There is a difference between someone who is managing a grant and someone who writes a grant.
We're talking about someone
who writes a grant, not someone that manages a grant. So there's a big difference.
And I would also refer you back to the article. It says grant writer slash facilitator. Pardon me. The article reads grant writer facilitator. So that says the grant writer will go get the grant and they will manage the grant.
Okay, but right now the manager that we're having manage that grant, those funds are coming out of the grant itself?
Oh, yes.
So they're not coming out of general fund?
That's correct.
Okay, so we're talking about taking money out of general fund to have this person manage the grant, where now it's being paid for out of the grant money that we're receiving. That goes into the tax base. It doesn't necessarily go out of the grant. So again, my question is, why do we need to pay someone an hourly wage? And like Michael said, give them benefits because they're going to end up with some type of benefits, holiday pay, or if they work enough hours, they're going to end up with health insurance and all of the other benefits that all of the other employees at 20 hours a week receive.
Just to finish my thought, the $80,000 could have come into the town and paid for this resource that we could, in fact, multiply that grant activity as well. So, again, my thought.
But you're using a professional grant manager, is that the deal?
Yes.
Okay. But
they go get them and they take them and bring them home.
But that's how they make their money. And that's how we get the grants, because we're not talking about someone who's coming in the door who kind of knows how to write grants because we hire them, and they're not a professional grant writing company that has multiple staff members. That's the difference, don't you think?
Mr. O'Connell.
This is a great idea. It's a good investment. We've seen what the highway department does with Cindy Thompson and Herb writing grants. In effect, we're doing it in that domain. I think we know what we're doing here, and I support this. I move the question.
Mr. Taff, if you want to speak, you can.
Move the question.
We've got two people along. Okay. Okay, motion is made and seconded to move the question and the debate. Okay. All those in favor of ending debate will say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed will say no. So the debate is over. Now we're voting on the article. Anybody need it repeated, Article 40? Okay. All those in favor of Article 40, would you please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no.
No.
That passes. Okay. 41. To see if the town will vote to amend Chapter 15 of the Personnel Bylaws, Section 2, Mandatory Classification, to include the position of Principal Assessor, or take any action relative thereto.
Mr. Moderator.
Okay.
I move that the town vote to amend Chapter 15 of the Personnel Bylaw, Section 2, Mandatory Classification, to include the position of Principal Assessor at the grade and points to be determined by the Personnel Board.
Okay.
And I would yield the floor to my friend Al.
Go right ahead.
Somewhere around 2015, the decision was made to move away from an elected three-person part-time board of assessors to having one full-time individual staffing the assessing office. Initially, it was suggested the new job description should be titled Principal Assessor. However, it was then decided the elected assessors would remain in place while the part-time new hire learned the ropes. So the new job title was changed to Assistant Assessor, who would work under direct supervision. When my position became full-time, I questioned if I was still an assistant assessor since I no longer had any supervision. I met with the personnel committee, and they agreed the assistant assessor job description did not fit my actual job duties and responsibilities. But they told me the creation of any new position has to be voted on at town meeting. Whenever anyone calls or visits the office and asks me my title, I tell them I'm assistant assessor. Then they ask to speak to an assessor. Then I have to explain that there is no assessor. They only come in for meetings and on other occasions. That I am the assistant assessor. The elected assessors are not available. I'm considered the department head and the day-to-day decision maker. So I'm requesting the position of principal assessor be created. I'm not seeking any raise in wages or the number of hours worked per week. And I want to note that the wording at the end, which says grades and steps of position to be determined in the future, was not added by the assessor's office or myself.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. O'Connell.
I'm here to support this article and to give a terrific shout out of praise for the work Al has done this year. It's made a huge difference.
Any other discussion on the article? Okay. If not, all those in favor, would you please say aye?
Aye.
All those opposed say no. Okay, and that's approved. Okay, 42. To see if the town will vote pursuant to the provisions of Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 59, Section 38, as written in this rest of the paragraph. Who's got this one?
Mr. Moderator, I move that the town vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen to enter into two agreements for payment in lieu of taxes as identified in Article 42 of the town warrant for up to 20 years and upon such terms and conditions as the Board of Selectmen shall deem in the best interests of the town, and to take such actions as might be necessary to implement such agreements.
Good. Motion made and seconded. Oh, you're back.
I'm back. Yes vote on this article allows the Board of Selectmen to enter into and negotiate pilot agreements on each of the two solar installations on South Maple Street. This has nothing to do with Article 13 earlier, which was a temporary moratorium. Voting down this pilot article will not prevent any solar from going forward on those parcels, but it would prevent the town from receiving any tax money, pilot money, which is payment in lieu of taxes. The first year, I'm estimating that we would get $16,446 from those two solar installations combined.
Anybody else? Okay. All those in favor of the article, would you please say aye?
Aye.
All those opposed, no. All right, that one's approved.
40.
Next one, 43. To see if the town will vote pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 82A, Section 2, to designate the Highway Department as the town's office to issue permits for the purpose of creating a trench, as that term is defined by said Chapter 82A, Section 4 and 520, January 14, or take any action relative thereto. Okay, who's got this one?
Mr. Moderator.
Yes, Mrs. Lincoln.
I move that the town vote pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 82A, Section 2, to designate the Highway Department as the town's office to issue permits for the purpose of creating a trench, as the term is defined by said Chapter 82A, Section 4, and 520 CMR.
Second.
Okay.
And I was just going to tell them, this is now mandated by state law.
Any discussion on this one? If not, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Okay. Article 44.
Mr. Moderator?
Yes.
I move that the town vote to transfer $11,676.78 to the available general fund to the from the available general fund to the fleet repair replacement account. This is monies being returned to the town.
Okay. As I told the advisory board and the selectmen before the meeting, it's a shame that the town accountant isn't here, because in the 50 years plus that I've been attending town meetings, there's never been a transfer out of something, the general fund. So, I'm not an accountant, I don't have anything to do with it, so we're going to let it go, but just be aware that, whatever. Okay? Any other discussion? All right, if not, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. Okay, it's a vote. Article 45, to see if the town will vote to transfer a sum of money from the general fund to the fleet repair and replacement account or take any action relative thereto.
Mr. Moderator.
Yes.
I move that the town vote to transfer $18,724.72 from the available funds in the general fund to the fleet repair replacement and replacement account.
Okay. Any discussion on this one? If not, all in favor, please.
Mr. Moderator.
Sorry, I was waiting for the microphone.
What's that?
Sorry, I was waiting for the microphone, sorry.
Yeah.
I was wondering if the highway chief could tell us what he plans on doing with that money, if it's already earmarked for something or not. Did he leave? Did he leave? Oh, here he is.
No, I'm here. Well, what's it say it's going into?
I can read what it's going into. I didn't know if you had a specific plan for it. Because if not, I think we should put it into the snow and ice budget because that's what the money was for, correct? Isn't that what FEMA is paying us for?
That's from the cleanup of the October snowstorm.
Right. Snow.
Oh, that's not snow and ice. That's a whole different volume than that storm.
Well, it's...
It's for debris removal. How's that? And debris cleanup. That was for the rest of it that we finally got because we kept chasing them.
So it's also not for fleet repair then either, right?
What was the question?
Oh, you said it's not for snow and ice. I said then they're not also paying you to repair the fleet either, correct?
Well, how the heck do you think we cleaned up the town? We didn't clean it up with our fingers and stop being carried away. We had to use equipment.
I think you're very funny, and that's a great answer, but I didn't know what you broke during the prime. That's why I was asking what you were using it for.
We had to use town equipment to clean up the roads. So I'm making a recommendation to put it into the fleet repair replacement account for later on, if needed.
And if needed, the fleet repair replacement account gets funded by the town. Is it the general fund we need? I'm not familiar where it normally comes from when you need it.
It's voted at town meeting.
Okay. So why wouldn't we put this toward our big snow and ice deficit?
Because it's not part of snow and ice. It's not a debris removal from trees coming down. Do you remember that?
No, I don't. I wasn't here. I was in Florida. Mr. Moderator.
Yes.
I'd like to make a motion that we move the money, the $18,724.72, into the toward our snow and ice budget. So that would put our snow and ice budget at $93,724.72 starting out. No.
That ain't gonna work.
We don't have the town accountant here, and I am not an accountant, so I'm just going to put that disclaimer up front, okay? That's probably the best recommendation anybody could make right now. But this money, the way that the last article was structured, it was funds that had come in the same fiscal year, okay? It's money that came in the fiscal year. It was a one-time payment. Under typical circumstances, that money would basically sit in a general fund, and then sometime next year when we file our Schedule A and do all of our filing for free cash, that's when the money would come back to the town. In the previous article, by allocating it now, we, in essence, move it into the fleet repair replacement account prior to the turn of the fiscal year, and those monies are getting transferred in this current year. This one's a little bit more complicated. I actually, the voice from the back of the room probably has the best idea on this one, is that I would make a motion that we pass this over.
Second. All right, motion is made to pass over. Any discussion on passing it over?
I just wanted to, if I'm in order, Mr. Moderator, the Capital Planning Committee feels that, unlike Article 44, this one should go should be allowed to flow into the general budget, which helps us build free cash. The original costs for the highway department and so forth really did come out of the general operating budget, so this is basically putting it back into the general operating budget. With the previous article, I believe the fleet repair replacement account now has about $55,000 in it already. Our capital planning committee has concerns about that fleet repair and replacement account, because potentially that money in fleet repair and replacement only requires the selectman's approval to spend it. Therefore, a new vehicle could be approved by the selectmen without a town meeting vote, and we feel that new vehicles should be subject to a town meeting vote, that fleet repair and replacement be used only for the acquisition of used equipment where time is of the essence in making a purchase. That was the original purpose of the fleet repair and replacement account, was to allow Herb, for example, to be able to go to an auction. The money would be available, and he could acquire a used vehicle or parts to meet a need in the highway department at much less cost. So, the short answer here is, I think the Capital Planning Committee supports passing over this article.
Any other discussion on passing over this article? That was the motion, right?
Just one point.
Okay, go ahead.
To Mr. O'Connell via the moderator, we'll get some updated numbers to the Capital Improvement Planning Committee, because the point at which the CIPC reviewed the funding level in the fleet repair replacement account, there were a number of transactions that had not been transacted in VADAR, and the current balance is actually significantly lower than that. So the current balance is approximately $23,000. So we're no longer in a position where it looks like somebody's like saving up for a new vehicle or anything like that. So it's at a good level from a standpoint of if we did have an opportunity for used equipment, but it wasn't being overfunded. Okay.
All right, any other discussion? The motion is up there to pass over this article. I just want stuff on passing it over, yes or no? Okay. All right, all those in favor of passing over the article, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed to passing it over, please say no.
No.
Okay, that article is passed over. All right, Article 46. To see if the town will approve the capital improvement plan for FY19 through FY24, with the proviso that individual capital items included in the plan shall be submitted by the appropriate department head and or committee for town meeting approval, or take any action relative thereto. Who's got this one?
I do. Mr. Moderator?
Okay, you're up.
I move that the town vote to approve the capital improvement plan for FY19 through FY24 with the proviso that individual capital items included in the plan shall be submitted by the appropriate department head and or committee for town meeting approval.
Okay, any discussion on, yes, go ahead.
Given that the budget process this year was somewhat problematic, given that we didn't have any free cash, and a number of articles, capital articles, came in late in the year and were not able to be reviewed by the Capital Planning Committee, we feel that the capital plan that we submitted to the selectmen and proposed for acceptance by the town is really very different from what we have today. So therefore, our Capital Planning Committee prefers to pass over this article and to continue to work on a capital plan, hopefully to be presented to the town meeting in the fall, that represents the town's current financial situation. So I move to pass over Article 46.
Okay, motion is made and seconded to pass over the article. Any discussion on that? All those in favor of passing it over, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. Okay, that one's passed over.
Mr. Moderator?
Yeah, give me a second here.
Yep.
Crossing out these things here. Article 48.
I move that...
To see... Go right ahead.
I move that the town vote to transfer $40,000 from the ambulance reserve receipts account to the fund the fiscal 2019 emergency squad expense account.
Okay. Any discussion on this one? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. That's a vote. Article 49.
Mr. Moderator.
Yes.
I move that the town vote to transfer $180,760 from the ambulance reserve receipt account to fund the fiscal 2019 emergency squad wages account.
Okay, any discussion on this one? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. Okay, that's a vote. Article 50. To see if the town vote to transfer a sum of money from the water surplus account to the water main improvement account or take any action relative thereto.
Mr. Moderator.
Yes.
I request to move that the town move transfer $30,000 from the water department surplus account to the water main improvement account. The purpose of the request is to cover the expected costs associated with the water main improvement on Central Street and including the increased size of the water main at the town hall.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Any discussion on this one? Okay, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. Okay, Article 50 is approved.
You got it, Don? I can get Mr. Moderator?
Just a second here. I got to. The two guys up here have to make sure that we have the numbers right tonight. Okay, Article 51. To see if the town will vote to transfer a sum of money from the water surplus account to the water pump account or take any action relative thereto.
Mr. Moderator.
Yes, sir.
I move that the town vote to transfer $20,000 from the water surplus account to the water pump account.
Okay. Okay, good. Any discussion on this one? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Okay. Mrs. Lincoln.
Yes. I move that the town vote to adjourn this session of the annual town meeting and reconvene at 6:30 p.m. on Thursday, June 28th at the Brookfield Elementary School, 37 Central Street, Brookfield.
Second. Okay. Any, just before people get up and leave, what that means is we've had notice of one reconsideration. And then we'll pick up with all the articles that haven't been acted on. So all those in favor of adjourning to June 28th, 6:30, back here. Please say aye.
Aye.
What's that? I can't, you need to get up here and speak. I can't hear it, what you're saying.
You didn't ask for any discussion.
Are you accepting discussion, Donald?
Yes.
I'm questioning whether we're going to have free cash certified. And even if we do have free cash certified, coming to a discussion of all the money articles, it really gives very little time for either the advisory committee or the capital planning committee to have a substantive discussion about what kind of free cash we have. So I just want to know whether an option, maybe from town council through the moderator, can we simply not take up the money articles when we have an adjourned town meeting and simply refer them to a fall town meeting, which would give everyone a real chance to understand what the town's financial situation is?
We're looking up one thing, please. Michelle.
Sure. I mean, you can vote if we adjourn to the 28th. And let me try and answer it. We can adjourn till the 28th, and if that night we want to pass over everything, we pass over it, and we'll be done in 15 minutes. And if we want to discuss it, we'll be here for a while. There are also, this motion that was made would also include the bylaws that are listed, articles 50,
yes, right,
2 to 7, I forgot what numbers they are at this point, would include discussion of that. So everything we haven't acted on tonight would be fair game. And if people want to pass it over, we certainly could at that point.
57, we were going to pass over those until the fall town meeting.
Okay. So in effect, that if this motion is passed, or this adjournment is agreed to by the town meeting, then everything comes up for discussion at the adjourned town meeting that we haven't reviewed, and could be subject to motions to pass over by the Capital Planning Committee for or others. Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other discussion on 6:30, the 28th? Okay, the final vote of the evening. All those in favor of adjourning until 6:30 p.m. Thursday, right back here. All those opposed, say no.